So I'm very pleased to welcome all of you to our first book celebration of the year. We are here to honor our friend and colleague, Odette Lienau, Associate Professor of Law here at the Cornell Law School, upon the publication of her monograph, Rethinking Sovereign Debt, Politics, Reputation, and Legitimacy in Modern Finance, available from better bookstores everywhere. We've got an excellent lineup of commentators to parse the finer points of the argument in today's book, but before we actually get to the outside and inside speakers, we're going to depart slightly with convention, and Odette herself will provide an introduction to some of the book's arguments, and more specifically explain the genesis of the project and how it came to be the focus of her research. After that, we'll hear from Jonathan Kirshner, who is Stephen Barber Friedman Professor of International Political Economy in the Government Department here at Cornell. He's an expert on international relations and has also done important contributions in political economy, especially macroeconomics. He also has a number of diverse other interests, including 70s film, for which he's written some important work. And his current research project, amongst other things, is related to the incredibly urgent topic of the international political implications of the financial crisis, which I think dovetails quite nicely with a lot of the research that's being done in the law school by our colleagues in financial regulation. So we're especially grateful to have Jonathan here today. Following Professor Kirshner, we will have Robert Howse, who is Lloyd C. Nelson Professor of International Law at NYU Law School. He holds an LLM from Harvard, and he's been a visiting professor at Harvard, Tel Aviv, Hebrew, and Paris One, as well as Osgoode Law School. He's also taught at the European University Institute in Florence. He's the author or editor of at least six books that I can count, including Trade and Transitions, Economic Union, Social Justice, and Constitutional Reform, The Regulation of International Trade, Yugoslavia, the Former and Future, as well as several other books and important articles. Finally, we'll hear from Professor Adam Feibelman, who is Associate Dean for Faculty Research and Sumter Davis Marks Professor of Law at Tulane University Law School. His recent scholarship includes Europe and the Future of International Monetary Law, which is forthcoming in Transnational Law and Contemporary Problems, as well as Involuntary Bankruptcy for States, which was published in the Duke Journal of Constitutional Law and Public Policy. So without further ado, I'll turn over the podium to Professor Lienau. Oh, sorry. Before that, I forgot. I was remiss that when I discussed Rob Howse, I forgot to mention his latest book. I discussed all the previous books and forgot to discuss the latest book, which is Leo Strauss, Man of Peace, recently published, which includes this excellent cover. So that's also available at greater bookstores everywhere and is published by Cambridge University Press. So now to Odette.
So first I have many, many thank yous that I would like to issue. First, I want to thank the commentators for joining me today, especially Rob and Adam, who come from out of town, Jens for moderating and helping to organize this, the Dean's Office for supporting the event, the library, some of whom, there's some representatives of the library here, so thanks to the library for all of your help as well in finishing this book, and all of you for attending. It's really such a pleasure to be here and an honor to have this event organized for the book. So just about 5 minutes ago, Jens was like, well, why don't we just rearrange the schedule so you actually talk first? So I wasn't initially planning to. But I thought maybe I would present a little overview of where the book came from, why I was interested in this topic, and really kind of a little bit of what the book is about, very briefly, before turning it over to commentators. And then I guess I'll respond to questions from the audience and from the commentators afterwards. So what is the book about? I mean, it's a sort of grand title, Rethinking Sovereign Debt, Politics, Reputation, and Legitimacy in Modern Finance. But the book more closely looks at the norm of sovereign debt continuity. And this is the norm or the sort of background rule in international finance that sovereign state debtors have to repay their debt even after a major regime change, either that or they're going to suffer reputational consequences, right? So that's this norm of sovereign debt continuity. And it links to the idea or the doctrine of odious debt, which some of you may have heard of, which is the idea that if a debt did not benefit the underlying population, so for example was used to oppress the underlying population or something like that, or the underlying population did not authorize the debt, then it shouldn't be transferred to a subsequent regime if the regime, the government that contracted that arguably illegitimate debt actually falls, right? So I became interested in this idea a while ago, right, in part through discussions of transitional justice and regime change, right? So, you know, once you have post-apartheid South Africa, well, what happens to the apartheid-era debt? Does it make sense for the newly empowered black population to repay this debt, part of which was actively used to oppress them? And this comes up at regular intervals in international finance and international relations. I grew up in Indonesia, and so after the fall of Suharto, who's a dictator that had been in power for 30 years, there was some discussion that, well, you know, what should we do with that debt, some portion of which is probably in Swiss bank accounts. Again, after the fall of Saddam Hussein, you have a discussion, well, what should we do with that debt, right? And the response has been, when there have been efforts from civil society or legal scholars to say, well, why don't we have this new doctrine, this new idea, that some of this debt should not be continuous, the response from international finance, sorry to sort of make that large claim, has been, well, that's not possible, right? Because, you know, otherwise this is just a rule of international markets. You know, it's not a mean rule, it's just how markets work. And I thought, you know, well, what are the assumptions behind that, and to what degree do they really hold? And it seemed to me like there were three assumptions behind that rule. First, this idea that the rule of debt continuity is apolitical. Right, that it might have political effects, it might be considered unfair, but it's not a political rule, so you can't really challenge it. Second, that it's required by the reputational mechanism that underpins capital markets. And third, that creditors who are very powerful wouldn't really accept it any other way. Okay? And they're like, you know, it's very, very nice that the lawyers are putting together new doctrines, but actually none of this is relevant for the hard-headed world of international finance. Okay, so this seemed to me annoying, and also the smugness with which this narrative was told was annoying to me. So my goal in this book, in some ways, is to challenge the theoretical and historical assumptions for this rule and for this narrative. And I thought it seemed to me that this was theoretically wrong for several reasons. First, the idea that this norm is apolitical seemed to me very wrong, because underpinning the whole idea of sovereign debt and sovereign reputation is the idea of sovereignty. What is a state? This is one of the most deeply contested questions in international politics and international law over the last century, and this is a very political question, so the idea that this could be apolitical seemed unreasonable to me. Second, the idea that the reputational mechanism is set in stone. Well, that seems a little unreasonable too, right? Because if you accept the idea that a new regime is actually a new state, then why would you expect the reputation from the previous regime to attach to the new state? Wouldn't it just be a new borrower, like we have new companies or new countries that occasionally emerge? So that seemed open to me as well. And finally, the idea that creditors all speak in one voice seemed a little bit wrong to me too. Well, yeah, it's true that creditors ideally want all debtors to repay their debt. But in some situations, when creditors are competitive, for example, they'll say, hey, you know, I think it's potentially reasonable that this new country didn't want to repay the debt of the previous regime, and they have lots of iron ore or whatever, and seem like they'll have the capacity to repay the debt in the future. So you can imagine creditors in some situations, if they buy into an alternative reputational story, thinking that this is a reasonable thing to do to actually not insist on debt repayment. So these theoretical assumptions, I think, fall away. And also it seemed like the historical assumptions fall away. There's this assumption in a lot of political economy literature that this rule of debt repayment is basically consistent across all time. And a closer look at the history, which was sort of encouraged by this closer thinking about the theory, suggested that that was not the case, that actually there are instances in which countries have repudiated their debt, have not repaid after regime changes, and they haven't been punished in the same way as we might expect by capital markets. So if that's the case, well, what's the situation? How did this develop? If it is really contingent, if it's not set in stone, how did we come to the rule we have today? And that's basically how I started writing the book, right? Out of kind of an annoyance of this narrative that was out there, a decision that a lot of the theoretical assumptions underlying the narrative didn't actually seem to hold, and an identification of a certain amount of historical variation that seemed to need to be explained. So I'm not going to talk about the historical variation because that would take so much longer than however long I've already taken. But there are a couple factors I think are important. One are broader norms of sovereignty, which have, as many of you will know, shifted a lot in the last 100 years when I start my story. And also I think the second kind of factor that I think is important is creditor competition, which I think has also shifted a lot in the last 100 years, and creditor interactions. So I think I'll stop there. And hope that we're all kind of on the same page, and thank everyone again for joining.
Thanks. Thanks, Odette. Thanks, everybody, for inviting me to this. It's a real pleasure to be here. I was also taken by surprise by the opening statement, and what I learned from the opening statement was that, yes, I accurately grasped the important concepts in the book, and I will now try and salvage what's left of what I have to say, since they've been articulated so well by Odette. But I will stick with my agenda, which is three parts. One is I'm going to start with a few words of praise, and then I'm going to call attention to two themes that I found of particular importance to my home discipline of international relations. And then, time permitting, I'll kind of poke around at some pieces of business in the book that I found particularly interesting or that I wanted to push back against a little bit. So to open with praise, I'm not opening with praise on account of the occasion. Actually, I'm more of a kind of constructive and respectful disagreement and criticism kind of a guy, and so opening with praise is a painful experience for me. But I must open with praise because I was so impressed by the book, which offers a sweeping command of diverse, thoughtfully and appropriately selected cases while ranging freely across disciplinary boundaries. And as such, it's just a model of excellent and provocative scholarship. I would urge in particular younger scholars to look to it as what one might aspire to. I think it's a very, very impressive book, and I was pleased to have an opportunity to look at it again. So that's really the bottom line, and I think the most important thing I would take away from this discussion, but certainly there's plenty to discuss. And so one of the things that was suggested is that we look at the book from our own orientations. I come at this as an international relations scholar, and in that context, two things from the book, each of which you mentioned, really kind of jumped out at me, one of which pleased me greatly, and one of which made me squirm in my seat. So I will take I'll take the good first and the bad second. Bad for me, that is, not bad for the book. I think the good one is that from a perspective of an international relations scholar, the book makes a major contribution to our understanding of reputation in international relations. Or more specifically and bluntly, for the subfield of IPE or international political economy, subfield of international politics. Security studies scholars, and I say to a room full of lawyers, that means war and peace studies and international politics. I don't know anything about the other securities. Security studies scholars in IR do a very good job wrestling with the problem of reputation. They fight about it, and as a group, they don't actually agree on what it is or how it matters, but they contest it, and they have passionate advocates, and there's a nice thriving research agenda on the meaning and import of reputation. IPE scholars sound more like my mother-in-law talking to a young woman, which boils down to, think of your reputation. IPE scholars think they know exactly what reputation is, exactly how it's perceived, and exactly why and how it matters in a kind of a general way. And I think what Odette's book shows is that this is not the case. Their reputation can be contested, their reputation is often interpreted in different ways, and that the varied context of understanding reputational matters explains how you're going to the consequences of whether or not one's reputation will be sullied or burnished or what have you. In a related strength of the book, I would also call attention to the fact that the heterogeneity of creditor interests and behavior also shines through in this book in a way that I think is underappreciated in the IPE literature. I think it's fair to say that some of my work has been criticized for lumping finance together a little too easily, and so I think that this is, again, a welcome contribution, both to challenge the received notion in IPE of the concept of reputation, its meaning and how it plays out, but also to explore this issue of heterogeneity of creditor interests and behavior in different contextual settings. And in a sense, in a very good way, this really ought to shake up IPE scholars working in this area, though they are a pretty stubborn bunch. I would also note that these two characteristics that I most admired in the book are particularly clear in the Soviet example, which I found to be the most compelling case in a book full of very strong cases. And I'm also delighted, of course, to note here the fundamental geopolitical forces that are shaping the context of market behavior, something that I'm always alert to, but something that I think is always lurking somewhere near the surface of this book, sometimes explicitly, sometimes implicitly, and that's something I'm going to be interested in talking a bit more about. The contribution of this book that makes me squirm a bit in my seat is its core mission that we just heard, which is to kind of tug at this kind of idea of sovereignty or a very statist conception of world politics. Since, as an international relations scholar and a realist, I tend to traffic in states, and I'm very comfortable there. Whereas Odette wants to problematize the meaning of these concepts and does so forcefully and effectively. I would say, by means of my own pushback on this concept, that I was more easily convinced that the statist conception of debt responsibility or debt continuity was arbitrary and inappropriate than I was that there was an easy way out of that box. Those are two separate kind of sides of the equation. That is, we can let go of the state, and you can convince me that that's right as the kind of holder or the bearer of a continuous liability. But it was less obvious to me that we would know how to adjudicate and distribute those liabilities from there. And that's something might come up in conversation. If we agree with everything Odette says, where do we go from there kind of as a practical matter? This seems like a good moment to mention another thing I found to greatly appreciate in the book, and also mentioned in the beginning comments, which is its emphasis on the myth of the apolitical economic policy. There is no politically neutral economic policy. There is no bloodless technocratic ideal. You know, I've argued this, and many of you in this room I know have argued as well, that there stories we're told about an apolitical economic ideal are fables that are shielding the politics at the forefront of the matter, particularly, you know, in my case, the idea that every monetary policy has a more fundamentally political than economic context in most cases. And Rethinking Sovereign Debt reminds us that similarly, there is no technically correct or economically appropriate economic choice in this area, that political contestation remains inescapable. And I heartily endorse that. But that gives and it takes away, because it also speaks to this problem of resolving the issue. Like, if we recognize this as politics and we're prepared to reject it, we need to recognize at the same time that any other alternative approach will also be steeped in its own politics and political contestation. And I found that something I wanted to puzzle through more in thinking about the book. I'm Professor Kirshner and I'm a statist. I think that no matter how obviously flawed, once we reject this sanctity of continuity, once we get away from the state, and I fear I'm repeating myself here, but to my insecure grounding, I was concerned about being able to find the basis for which we would have a standardized method of addressing these issues, or whether there would be constant contestation of any possible choice. And I thought that the puzzling through of some of these ideas toward the end of the book were suggestive of this. But in any event, in these two areas, the role of reputation, especially in international political economy, and this challenging of the consequences of conceptions of sovereignty and state centricism, this book is making kind of important engagements with major issues in contemporary international relations theory, and in that sense it is welcome and very successful. So this is leads me to potpourri. How many minutes do you give me a number and I'll keep going until you tell me to stop.
5 to 6 minutes.
Sure. So just a handful of issues that I wanted to touch on that I was stimulated by when I was reading the book. To repeat, as suggested by my initial comments, I think the core argument of the book, articulated on page 2, reprised on page 19, the market narrative supporting the repayment norm is overly simplistic and in some respects entirely wrong. The debt continuity norm is intrinsically political. I think this is decisively shown in the pages that follow, and again is an important contribution and the sign of a very successful and important book. I think chapter 2, as I suggested in my earlier comments, puts a real hurting on much IBE literature in this area, especially in the early going, pages 25 and 27, engaging the possibility that creditors might be more nuanced in their interpretation of the meaning and consequence of debt continuity than the existing literature permits. And again, from there, this idea of creditor heterogeneity in behavior. I thought that, as I said, that the Soviet case is particularly thoughtful, nuanced, and powerful in the book, and highlights all of the positive attributes that I just suggested. So I will just leap ahead there to the Costa Rican case and just flag it as another exemplary case. But I would note once again, and the chapter does acknowledge this, the geopolitical context of these negotiations. And, you know, call a plumber, you're going to hear about pipes. And so for me, I was always kind of seeing a geopolitical framing to a lot of what was going on in these particular cases, so that the appeal to the arbitration process between Britain and Costa Rica as supervised by Americans reminded me of nothing more than the Venezuela boundary dispute of 1893, in which the U.S. chose a similar tack. And the broader theme was about the U.S. finding ways to disempower Britain in the context of the Western Hemisphere. And so when I saw Taft's somewhat muddled, quote-unquote, intermediate approach to these problems, what I thought was, well, maybe he's trying to preserve traditional norms, but at the same time trying to stick it to Britain. And in most of these cases, I commonly will see the role of geopolitics lurking not too far behind. I thought that the book made a very good argument about where the post-war order came from and why it then led us on a trajectory of the norm of sovereign continuity. But I was more skeptical, and this is where I'll lead toward my close, of whether this led us towards an optimistic conclusion. That is, are those forces dissipating, or are they, if anything, more powerful? And here in particular, as the book observes on several occasions, we see the increasing importance of private as opposed to public capital flows, which suggested to me that those factors that led to a very statist and narrow conception of these matters might only be reinforced and strengthened. Two very small pieces of business. I was just curious about the Nicaraguan case, especially in 176-77, if the Sandinista government's approach was motivated by a desire not thinking through so much about debt, but thinking that they did not want to make the Reagan administration even madder than it was in 1982, because they did have a tendency to assert themselves in a very profound way in the region. And as for Iran, the book has an argument that explains Iranian behaviors. No problem for the book. I was utterly puzzled by it. I'd be curious to hear more about why Iran stuck with this norm. Again, this it follows the logic of the book with the power of the continuity of the norm, and yet, you know, as a good book does, it chooses the hard cases. I'm still puzzled by the logic behind Iranian behavior as described in the chapter. Turn now to a final point, and here I'm thinking mostly of Chapter 7, and it touches on this question of the continuity associated with the post-war order. I think in Chapter 7, and this is perhaps my only real critique element of my comments today, is where Odette turns from analytical arguments and the host of cases and towards prospects. And to my eyes, the discussion becomes overly optimistic and sees perhaps in bending blades of grass more evidence for good things than I thought the arguments merited. And I think this is especially, again, because of the endurance of the norms and the relative power of private actors, which Odette emphasizes repeatedly in the book, are the ones most committed to the norm that we currently live with. I guess I left the book, this part of the book, not convinced by the tentative argument of the chapter that there are trends out there indicative of a longer-term shift. I think the behavior of goody-two-shoes Nordics are not indicative of global trends, and I think that the exceptional and ambiguous cases noted in this chapter are exceptional and ambiguous. I don't see I see the argument for the norm transformation that Odette makes in the book, and I think the book makes it in a forceful and compelling way. I don't see evidence that there's been much progress or indications of progress on that front, which is a very modest dissent from what I think is a truly outstanding book that I recommend to you all. Thank you.
So first of all, thanks for inviting me back to Cornell. It's great to be back here. And thanks to Jens for the very generous introduction and remembering, if at the end, to plug my new book, which I'm very excited about. And I hope you all get a chance to read. But we're here to talk about Odette's book. And before discussing my take on the substance of the book, I should just say that it's obvious that in our early careers, we usually have to write under constraints because we're writing almost necessarily for a professional advancement, at least if we're not foolhardy and we really do want to make careers as academics. And so sometimes very good ideas get packaged, you know, in formats that are influenced by the need to please mentors, committees, and so on and so forth, different disciplinary, you know, gurus. This is a wonderful book, and it doesn't display those kinds of limitations or constraints. Even if they existed, you don't notice them when you read the book. It reads like a ripping tale. And it combines very deftly conceptual or theoretical analysis, as Odette pointed to, about the very nature of the sovereign of the state as a juridical actor, as an agent in the international community, with a brilliant and compelling historical narrative, and very shrewd policy analysis, which I actually would have to differ with you a little. I did not detect as kind of a wildly optimistic prognosis. Before giving you my take on the substance, maybe I should say just one or two words about where I come from on this issue. It doesn't seem to have that much to do with the political philosopher Leo Strauss, although I would say that one of Strauss's most famous interlocutors, Alexander Kojève, with whom he had that famous debate about tyranny in the 1950s, was actually a major figure in international financial relations, an official for the French government who also was the head of the legal drafting committee for the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade. So there's some connection. But my connection to this topic goes back to before I was a law student, when I was a very young Canadian government official, and I was charged with monitoring and organizing negotiations of former Yugoslav debt. These were Paris Club negotiations, which meant official government-to-government debt. And so I began by seeing the regime and the norms that Odette deconstructs in this book from the inside. And then I only returned to this area, more or less, many years later, where I wrote about odious debt, deeply under the influence, I should say, of the scholarship of Ruti Taitel, who is a graduate of this law school. And I produced a piece for the OECD in 2007, where I actually, in a different way than Odette, using different kinds of intellectual sources, questioned this kind of grundnorm or fundamental notion that a sovereign always has to repay no matter what. And in that piece, I simply said about the issue that Odette really focuses on brilliantly in this book, reputation, that the verdict is out. People say reputation all the time, but where are the empirics? And Odette has admirably provided us with the empirics. So I'm not going to talk about odious debt so much, that part of the book, but more about the case study that isn't in the book, but is in the headlines now day after day, which is the Argentina debt situation. And it might be useful to think about whether what's evolving with Argentina supports Odette's fundamental hypothesis, or whatever degree of optimism or not is expressed in the book. So I'm just going to start off 2 minutes kind of getting everyone up to speed if you have been throwing out those old issues of the Financial Times about what's going on. Basically, a number of years ago, Argentina frontally challenged this this norm that if a sovereign doesn't repay 100%, 100 cents on the dollar, there's going to be doom and gloom. It basically pressured its bondholder creditors, mostly foreign bondholder creditors, into taking what are called in the lingo haircuts. In other words, exchanging the original instruments they held for new bonds that would be valued at much significantly less. Some estimates are 25 cents on the dollar, others around 30, than the original instruments. Over 90% of the bondholders at the time accepted this deal. I think it's like 92 or something, or 93, which in a way, in itself, is a vindication of Odette's thesis that this whole kind of norm as an absolute was actually quite fragile. And part of its fragility are some of the collective action issues that Odette deals with. In fact, the idea that the creditors or the market speaks with one voice and as kind of like a monopoly provider of financial services is a huge mistake. But it's somehow, as she shows, the kind of illusion on which this supposed absolute norm depends in a way for its enforceability. So we have 92-93% of these bondholders accepting this really big haircut. And then what happens, those who hold out, resell their debt to what we all now know are the vulture funds. And they sue in New York court and get an order by a judge who is now one of the most hated figures in Argentina, probably more hated than the colonels, Judge Grisa of New York, who basically says that Argentina has to pay the holdouts or the vulture funds that now own the bonds of the people who didn't agree to the restructuring 100 cents on the dollar, which through the triggering of various clauses means an absolute huge payout, because it means not only do they have to pay them 100% on the dollar, but then they have to give a comparable settlement to the already restructured creditors. That's the so-called RUFO or RUFO thing. But in any case, we're getting too technical. The basic point is that whereas the initial restructuring seems to very much support the thrust of Odette's argument, the bite back by the vultures in the New York court might seem to suggest that things are starting to go backward, to go the other way. But that isn't the end of the story by any means. What's happened now? Well, what's happened now is the supposed nuclear event that occurs where a sovereign can't repay, which is default, because what Judge Grisa ordered, and one of the reasons his order is controversial, not just hated in Argentina, but controversial in many international financial centers, is that he ordered that payment be stopped to the restructured creditors until Argentina had fully repaid the holdout vulture fund creditors. Now, it would have been one thing to say that the vulture funds were entitled to be fully repaid. It's quite another thing to basically take down the settlement with 93% of the creditors, bondholders who had decided to restructure voluntarily, albeit under enormous pressure, but still voluntarily in the sense that they could have held out like the other 7%. So where does things stand now? Argentina is in default, so that looks like we're in the pessimistic scenario of a more chaotic environment once the fragility of the traditional grid norm or fundamental principle has broken down. But what's interesting, and I think I'm going to end on this observation, is that Argentina still has access to capital. Default doesn't turn out to be, as it's always assumed to be under the absolute principle that Odette deconstructs in her book, so to speak, capital punishment, to use a bad pun. So what is the situation now? The situation now is that there's active trading in high-yield bonds in Argentina. And so instead of default simply meaning that the market punishes you by banishing you and cutting you off, instead what happens is that individual lenders simply assess the risk. A default, or quote-unquote default, or greefault, as it's now called in Argentina after the name of the judge, simply is an event that causes creditors to reprice certain instruments. But there are lots of people out there looking for high yields and who, even if the risk is repriced, are still very interested in lending. And so Argentina bonds, but also other emerging market bonds have been doing quite well, even despite the quote-unquote default, which I think in a way is strong support for Odette's thesis in the book. And just one final note. I think that we're also seeing some interesting developments in what I might call alternative finance. And this goes to sovereign wealth funds. It goes to the global investment strategy of BRICS like China, and indeed the creation of the new BRICS bank. And these developments, it seems to me, it's early days. Some people are skeptical about the BRICS bank. Some people are very concerned that China's involvement in these markets is connected to wanting to throw around geopolitical influence in nefarious ways. We could discuss all those issues. But I think the bottom line is the world is resembling even more today this notion of a diversity of financial markets and diversity of creditors that Odette develops so well in the book. So many, many congratulations. A great book, and really I would recommend it as a great read to all of you. Thanks.
Thanks so much to Odette for including me in the event. It's a real treat to be part of this conversation about her wonderful book here at Cornell, My First Trip to Ithaca, and to be rescued from the sauna that back home we call the hurricane season. One of the advantages of going third is that much of what I was going to say has been covered and quite well, so my remarks will be somewhat abbreviated because I'm, among other things, eager to hear Odette's responses to some of the foregoing comments and to hear questions that you all may have as well. So I'll jump right in and try to explain what I think, as someone coming at this as a commercial law person primarily, is the most important and exciting contribution of Odette's book, which is that I think she's opened up a whole new and much larger space for legal scholarship on sovereign debt than it's enjoyed until now. And furthermore, this intellectual space is much more interesting and ambitious and challenging than most of what's been written on the topic, including what I've written on the topic. So legal scholarship on sovereign debt is, as a field, is very young. It's really 10 or 15 years old as a field. And it's evolved largely in response to discrete and acute episodes and issues related to sovereign debt relief and restructuring. There have been flurries of scholarship on sovereign bond contracts, particular clauses like pari passu and collective action clauses, as well as flurries on work on the evolution of sovereign debt collection and the possibility of an international legal doctrine of odious debt that is very much a topic of the book. You get the idea. And each of these flurries has tended to be connected to a particular episode. So, for example, the recent litigation that Rob was referring to between Argentina and its holdout creditors has reignited interest in scholarship on the possibility of a sovereign bankruptcy regime or a formal sovereign debt restructuring mechanism. What Odette has done, I think, again, is to move beyond these relatively narrow and discrete topics to tackle broader, more fundamental matters. In particular, the relationship between legal issues related to sovereign debt and underlying questions about sovereignty. She's charted a path to a place where commercial law meets complicated questions of political theory and international relations. Here, the questions are analogous to ones that we grapple with in the first weeks of law school and other courses. What is a contract with a nation? What are the component factors that make it enforceable? Who has the authority or capacity to bargain on behalf of a nation? And digging even deeper, what exactly is this nation thing that is purportedly making enforceable promises? It's a space, a set of questions that most of us commercial law types who've been drawn to write about sovereign debt knew was there as we've been fighting over collective action clauses or pari passu or the design of a future sovereign bankruptcy regime. In fact, that's what drew folks like me, I think, to the topic. Sovereign debt combines all the fun stuff of commercial and financial law with the practical and conceptual complications arising from the fact that a central party is a sovereign nation or state. Contemplating a sovereign debtor, whatever that meant, made familiar topics like contract law and debt restructuring snap to life precisely because it involved numerous complications that shed interesting light on fundamental commercial legal issues. But if those of us writing about sovereign debt knew there was a bigger intellectual space out there where the uniquely sovereign aspects of sovereign debt lived and could be explored, most of us who've been writing in this field just didn't know how to get there or what to do once we got there. We just didn't have the tools. Unlike most of the others of us who have been writing on legal aspects of sovereign debt, Odette has the necessary combination of tools, expert understanding of the legal, commercial, and financial landscapes, as well as the facility with political theory and theoretical underpinnings of international relations, to give us a fully realized example of how to explore the intersection of these topics, which I think she's done in the book. As has been explained by the previous speakers. So at a crucial level of generality, Her book shows how the legal and financial relationships represented by what we call sovereign debt reflect a political theory, and how the underlying theory in turn affects those legal relationships. In so doing, she's both showed us what it means to have this kind of discussion and debate about sovereign financial obligations, and she's done it in impressive detail by setting down meticulously and meticulously supporting an initial set of propositions that have been summarized previously that I'm confident will frame that discussion and debate. And so skipping over the summary of things that have already been said, I'll just say that I think the book makes a very compelling argument, in my own view correct, that the historical examples are really counterexamples to the norm of debt continuity and state succession, and the recent ascendancy of competing underlying theories of sovereignty should, at the very least, demolish our confidence in the inevitability of the norm of state continuity and debt repayment. And ideally, the counterstory that Odette tells should help open up space for a more serious consideration of the grounds and circumstances under which repudiation of sovereign debt is both acceptable and consistent with our views of statehood, sovereignty, and authority. So I guess I'm somewhat more sanguine than Jonathan. So let me mention one particular highlight for me, and then a couple of questions. And the one highlight that, in addition to all of the rich historical examples, and I can't remember which of you mentioned this, but the account of the kind of entrenchment or re-entrenchment of the statist concept of sovereignty in the post-World War setting was particularly useful, I thought, and reminded me, as someone who plows a slightly different field, of how the post-war order really was dependent on a particular idea of statehood and nation states participating in institutions like the United Nations and the IMF and so on and so forth, and how those institutions then, as is nicely described in the book, helped in entrenching the book by kind of taking the position that they couldn't interfere in the political activities of their members or their borrowers, which, as Jonathan notes, is not an apolitical proposition, right? That reflects a political theory. And as part of this post-war era, also reminding us that this was a time when many states were kind of newly created, many post-colonial, and many of these states, and especially their leaders, were all the more determined to kind of embrace a kind of traditional idea of statehood, right? Once they had kind of joined the club, they weren't interested in that being diluted and their power base being diluted. So a couple of questions. One which kind of piggybacks on the maybe indirectly on the Argentina example question, which is the way I kind of thought of the question is much of the kind of argument in the book or the examples are focused on this question of state debt continuity in the context of regime change. And so the question that I had was how we should understand the relationship between conceptions of sovereignty and the norm of repayment and continuity in general, absent regime change, in kind of more kind of prosaic examples of financial distress. And so the Argentina example, I think, provides a nice case study. Is there how does this relate to kind of concepts of sovereignty, and how might those inform how that plays out in legal settings? The other question that I had was how exactly we know when averments or kind of evidence of things related to sovereign obligations, repayment, and state succession actually reflect an underlying concept of sovereignty as opposed to serving some other function, perhaps pretextual or rhetorical. So a couple of examples. Debtors and creditors presumably both have an interest in reinforcing a repayment norm, right? And so presumably it's at least some expressions of a status concept of sovereignty in the sovereign debt context are signals, right? And I think this is something you note in the book, signals by the parties that they expect that the debt will be repaid. And how do we tease out that use of the concepts from a more underlying kind of actual theory that may be at work? I think I'll stop there. I have not much more to say, and there's not much time left, so I think I'll stop and pass it over back to Odette. Thanks.
So thank you again for your very generous and thoughtful comments. So I guess, I want to open it up to the audience as well, but I think I'll go through and respond to some of the key points that you raised to start. So I guess I'll start with Jonathan, where you buy into the idea that maybe we don't want to stick with a traditional statist approach, but you're not sure if you buy into any other idea. And I'm completely with you, actually. Even though I am fairly sympathetic to alternatives, to the suggestion that states aren't just entities that happen to hold the guns and therefore control the population and territory, I'm not sure how far in the other direction I want to go, right? Do you really want to insist on some kind of democratic foundation for international finance? I think that's probably going too far. Maybe some kind of minimum level where you understand states as basically agents for the underlying population that are required to act in their benefit without necessarily having some Enlightenment's idea of popular consent is, I think, how far I would go. Another response is, I'm not convinced we really need to decide this, right? Because a lot of what's going on is not we're going to set up an institution that's going to determine, A, the political theory that applies to international finance in general, and also how it applies in particular areas. A lot of this is going to be kind of behind closed doors in the negotiations themselves. And a lot of what's happening there is atmospherics and sort of a background understanding of what's appropriate at the time. And so I think to the extent that there's a shift in the discussion, in the discourse of roughly what's appropriate, without necessarily identifying a clear legal rule, that's actually still sort of a shadow of a rule. So I'm kind of with you, and I know that's a little wishy-washy, but that's in fact how I feel. I would also point out that I think a lot of times the people that are supporting one or another view in, for example, the political arena or the financial arena don't understand the way in which that view will have ramifications elsewhere. So, for example, sometimes you'll get kind of debt cancellation advocates that say, this is unjust, we don't want to be forced to pay the debt of the previous regime, they violated human rights, they were acting inappropriately. That same group of people are also precisely the people, at least sometimes, that say we don't want any kind of neo-imperial external monitoring of what we're doing within our own country. And these two things in some ways conceptually go together, right? So I think that ambiguity is actually deeper in more of the activists than they realize themselves. So that's sort of where I go with this, and it's a little bit wishy-washy, but I think it's sort of an area in which it's hard to take a hard line. I think the highlighting the geopolitics behind a lot of it is important, and I would occasionally get questions, well, geopolitics is everywhere. Why isn't it in your 2x2 table where you talk about broader norms and creditor competition, but geopolitics is everywhere? I think part of what I'm doing in this book is not denying that powerful actors in their use power to promote their interests, but suggesting, well, what is the broader structure in which the power gets used and the interests are formed? And so even if I think there's geopolitics at particular case levels, at work in particular interactions, I think my research agenda was looking at the power of the norm itself over time to enable particular actions rather than to explain particular state or financial action, actor actions at a specific time. And I am, you know, there are political scientists in the room. There's a large preference for parsimonious theory, a small theory that explains a huge amount of variation in the world. I tend to find that overrated. I think you pick your piece of the research agenda and try to do that well, and other and recognize that other people are going to have other contributions to make as well. So that's sort of my view. Overly optimistic, insufficiently optimistic. You know, I don't know. I think I change my mind every given day how optimistic I am. So that was how optimistic I was when the editor was like, you must submit it now. So Rob, you asked some very interesting questions about Argentina, and this fits into questions that you were asking as well about how does the Argentinian case fit into what I'm talking about, and especially how in a situation where there isn't necessarily a regime change, but some of these factors still seem to be relevant, how that fits in. So I sort of contemplated, you know, Argentina's always been there in sovereign debt, basically since the beginning of sovereign lending to Latin America. But because it wasn't a regime change situation, I decided not to include it. But I think maybe that was sort of a wussy thing to do. But, you know, I think I had reason to not include it, but I'll try to sort of talk a little bit more about it now. I think there is continuity in the rules that govern odious debt or arguably odious debt type situations where there is a kind of regime change, and the rules that are more generally applicable. And in particular, I think when you have a strict financial rule that says, look, debt must always be repaid, and that's the rule, even if it's actually violated, it still actually gives sort of bargaining power to the creditors who say, well, this is the rule, so we might forgive the debt, but we're going to extract major concessions from you in exchange for that. So I think if that rule is present in the odious debt situation, in a situation of regime change, in a situation as debtor sympathetic as, for example, you know, post-apartheid South Africa, which did acknowledge the debt of the previous regime, That actually really protects all of the capital flows in every other case, right? Because if you can say, look, even in that super sympathetic debtor situation, we're insisting on that rule, how can you, merely Argentina, without a massive regime change that oppressed 95% of the population or whatever, expect us to shift in any other way, right? So I think there's actually a degree of continuity in thinking about the rules in these situations that makes the odious debt discussion, even though it's in some ways marginal to international finance, marginal in that it actually protects the margins of where we can discuss, right? So I think that's sort of important to keep in mind. In terms of some of the discussion that's falling out from Argentina, I think it's actually been very helpful. And, you know, Argentina's been a little bit excoriated for why did you do this stupid thing? You know, you should just negotiate with these vulture fund holdout creditors and that will be much better for you. I am sympathetic to the idea that that this would be problematic because if they did that, there are contract clauses that suggest that they would have to extend the same offer to all these other creditors. It's unclear at this point whether those creditors would actually insist upon it. There are a number of technical steps that you will find boring that would have to be passed if they were actually going to do this. But nonetheless, Argentina believes it, and so it's part of the political reality of what they're talking about. So whether or not this was a good choice for Argentina, I'm actually, frankly, a little bit grateful to Argentina for doing this, because what they have done in deciding not to pay these vulture funds is highlight the general problem in debt restructuring. And even though they did not, as at least recently, as part of this debt restructuring, undergo a major regime change, there are many countries that are suffering under debt burdens that were entered into under regimes that were, you know, everyone basically agrees are terrible. And sometimes, you know, we're trying to indict the former leaders at the International Criminal Court and then turning around and saying, oh, but that leader is the same as you guys, so you still have to repay the debt. There's this real disconnect in different areas in what's going on. And I think the Argentina case has really sort of blown the lid off that whole discussion and highlighted not just how these hedge funds are acting within Argentina to sort of undermine a restructuring that is probably in the best interest for the vast majority of creditors as well as Argentina, but also putting a little bit greater attention on how their actions are affecting other countries that don't have the political willpower to say no, as Argentina did. So, you know, Zambia, a number of other countries who just ended up settling with these hedge funds because they didn't have the political power not to settle. And incidentally, some of that settlement money is your and my tax dollars, because they only had that money because they went through these multilateral debt relief initiatives where the debt was forgiven, basically. So I think there's a lot of interesting things going on there. And I think the pressure for debt restructuring, the moving this all into the discussion, some of the continuity between the rules in odious debt situation and the kind of regular debt situation are sort of important things to keep in mind. So let's see. Adam, you talked also about how do we know that we're really talking about sovereignty as opposed to just making, say, yes, of course we believe that it's always continuous because that's what's required to get things done. This is something that I think is difficult to figure out, but I'm not sure if it's so separate, right? Because what I'm interested in is figuring out or identifying the power of the norm itself, right? Because I think if you feel obligated to say, yes, I agree that the statist, it's the same country, we're going to pay, but please, could you still let us have a 30% discount, right? A 30% haircut. That is actually, even if the country doesn't believe it and really thinks they should get the 30% haircut because the previous government was terrible and this is actually an odious debt situation, not a state situation, the requirement that they buy into that larger norm, and I'm interested in identifying the power of the larger shared norm, the shared rule, rather than particular individual beliefs, I think is still present. So that's sort of how I would do it, because I think you're right. It's hard to know really what a country, a government is thinking. This is, you know, one of the classic problems in doing any kind of empirical work in international relations, where you can ask, well, what is it to ask a country? Is it to ask the leader? Which leaders? You know, probably they're going to have to lie sometime. So I think that that's sort of an intractable problem in general. So I think I'll stop there. And
please join me in graduating Professor Lienau, and also thank you for the distinguished comments.
Thank you, guys.